got, what do we have, like 15, maybe 20? I think we'll get started at just making sure that this is streaming. Yep, this is all streaming, making sure it's muted. Yes, it's muted. Okay, let me come back to you guys. Okay, let's view that waiting room. Yep, people are dropping in right now. I think what I will do is I will, I'll start admitting everyone. I'll just hit admit all. I'll keep obviously a kind of an eagle eye on whether, oh, Stephen Shavira is joining us. Awesome. I'll keep an eye on whether any strange troll-like behavior starts to emerge, but I don't expect it. Again, what I'll do is I'll do maybe a 6-minute, 7-minute introduction of just what the lecture series is. I'll read your introduction, Peter, the bio you sent me, and David, yours. And then Peter, you can take it off. At the end of your talk, I'll just say thank you. And David, if you want to jump straight in, you can. I'll be taking notes. I'll be ready to jump in also. And I think we can just wing it in the conversation for a half an hour for sure. And I see some people in the waiting room who are for sure going to have stuff they want to talk to Peter and probably you also, David, about. So I think we can just let the conversation evolve. Does that sound good to you guys?
Yeah, that's pretty much what I expected.
Okay, super. All right, let me start recording. And I'm letting everybody in. Hi, everybody. We're going to start in just 1 or 2 minutes. I'm keeping an eye on the waiting room. I see a few familiar faces in there. Weston, hi. I think Stephen is with us today too. Eldridge, hi, Eldridge. Hi, everybody. So let's begin. Good day, everyone. Good afternoon to some of you. Probably good morning to some others. My name's Ed Keller, and I'm the host of the Overview Effect Lecture Series this week and last week. I'm the co-director with Carla Leitao of the Postplanetary and Universal Design Program at the New Center. And I'm a creative director this year of the Space and Planetary Design Track at the Venice Biennale, the Architecture Biennale, as part of the Italian Pavilion. This year, under the curation of Alessandro Mellis, a virtual pavilion was organized in part due to the delays of the pandemic. Tom Kovac is the curator of the Italian Virtual Pavilion through his CityX Venice project. And we have about 22 creative directors working with Tom to put together a very wide and international range of designers, thinkers, practitioners, working both in architecture and urban design, but also in parallel to or outside of it. So many thanks to Alessandro Mellis, Tom Kovac, and their teams for making this series of events possible this year. Also many thanks to the brilliant designers, thinkers, writers, speculators who've joined the extended series of exhibitions, events, lectures, symposia, and performances, which the CityX Venice Architectural Biennale is making possible this year. So as a creative director, I put together this first series of a number in our Space and Planetary Design track. It is positioned as a survey of some of the key operational themes, which we could say are critical to post-planetary and universal design. And we've brought 4 guests in to speak in this initial series, an architect, engineer, historian, Lydia Kallipoliti, an AI developer, mathematician, philosopher, Ben Goertzel. They spoke last week. And this week, a science fiction author, marine biologist, our guest today, Peter Watts. And tomorrow, a transdisciplinary geographer and ecologist, Stephanie Wakefield. And by bringing this very wide range of disciplinary thinkers and makers together, we're trying to engage the question of how disciplinary boundaries could be reshaped effectively and critically toward a universal modality of design thinking. One or two words about what it would mean to think through planetary and post-planetary and universal design. As architects, urbanists, infrastructural designers, system thinkers, economists, ecologists, science fiction writers. We navigate and negotiate with the intertwined webs of human energy expenditure and information flow and their impacts on civilization and all species on the planet. The challenge now is to envision new configurations at the edge of our comfort zone. For example, architecture's conception of itself as a discipline for hundreds of years has depended on a model of the artificial in relation to the natural and the primal human action in the wilderness. Build a hut or make a bonfire. So this tension between codex of preservation or rituals of conflagration also configures and operates at the very base of organic and planetary life. We're all on fire chemically somehow, right? And the negative entropies of design, how we attempt to combat those expenditures. So design can become a radically temporalized act, both in terms of how it sees the world and in how it operates upon the world. It can function as an amplifier or an attenuator for the planetary broad spectrum codex of our historical, organic, material, and socio-technical configurations. We all live and operate across a deep arc of temporalities, from the moment of a gesture or the life of a single organism to the millennia-long presence of a building, a law, a city, or an ecosystem, or the billions of years of our planet. Now, we've chosen the term overview effect for this initial lecture series in the space and planetary design track at the Architecture Biennale because it describes a shift in the perception of scale and perception of value that astronauts have experienced sometimes when seeing the Earth from orbit. Famously, the first images taken from the moon looking back at the Earth offered everyone a partial access to this shift cognitively in our ability to grasp scales. So we're adopting this idea just as a provocation with these amazing guests who are joining the lecture so that we can rethink from different points of view what it would mean to be designers of architectures, of infrastructures, of ecosystems, and indeed of our entire planet. So let me introduce our two guests today. Our speaker today is Peter Watts. Thank you so much for joining us, Peter. Peter has been incredibly generous over the years in joining many conferences that I've convened and seminars that we've run. It's an incredible pleasure always. So thank you so much. Peter is a former marine biologist. He is also a flesh-eating disease survivor and convicted felon, long story as he puts it himself, whose novels, notwithstanding an unhealthy focus on space vampires, have become required texts for university courses ranging from philosophy to neuropsychology. His work is available in 23 languages, has appeared in 32 best of year anthologies, and has been nominated for 59 awards. His list of 22 wins includes the Hugo, the Shirley Jackson, and the Seiun. Peter seems to be especially popular in countries with a history of Soviet occupation. He lives in Toronto with fantasy author Caitlin Sweet, four cats, a pugilistic rabbit, always good, jump, a plecostomus the size of a school bus, a bearded dragon, and a gang of tough raccoons who shake him down for kibble on the porch every summer. Our guest today is David Roden. Thank you so much also, David, for joining us. David's research has addressed the relationship between deconstruction and analytic philosophy, philosophical naturalism, the metaphysics of sound, and posthumanism. His monograph, Posthuman Life, Philosophy of the Edge of the Human, in 2014, explored the ethical and epistemological ramifications of speculative posthumanism, the thesis that there could be agents originating in human social technical systems that become posthuman as a result of some technological alteration of their powers. His current work considers posthumanist theories of agency and their implications for aesthetics and philosophical method. Roden also writes experimental fiction and concept horror work. His novella Snuff Memories is published by Schism Press in 2021. He teaches at the Open University, UK. So I'm gonna hand it over to Peter Watts right now. Peter is gonna deliver a lecture, I think about an hour, give or take. And then we will have a conversation with David Roden. And after perhaps 30 or 40 minutes of conversation, we'll open it up to a Q&A to all the guests in the call. So Peter, take it away.
Okay, well, thanks, Ed. Hello, everybody. Notwithstanding all of Ed's previous comments, I still feel a little bit weird about giving a lecture on evolutionary biology and the cognitive future of human neurology. in a series of lectures that's supposedly about architecture and design. All I can say is that Ed knows what I was going to talk about. He said it was great. So if you find yourself kind of pissed off that you're getting something that's completely different than what was advertised, you know who to blame. My ass is covered. I'm going to start by sharing the screen. And I'm going to make sure that sound and everything is okay. And everyone can see everything? My screen's shared? We take it away.
Yes.
Bless you.
Sorry, he's got a touch of flu.
Yeah, it's going round.
Here we go. We'll just have a little lie down. Yeah? You're going somewhere nice?
Just getting away for a bit. Somewhere no one can find me.
God, that sounds great. We're off on holiday to the south of France.
Oh, nice. It's a long way by coach.
I know. It's just, you know, the environment.
Yes, we should all think of that.
I don't want to sound like a twat, but I just, you know, I do think that we've all got a responsibility. I just do.
No, you're right. We do. We all do. Why did you have him then?
Sorry?
Nothing uses carbon like a first world human, yet you created one. Why? Why would you do that? He will produce 515 tons of carbon in his lifetime. That's 40 trucks worth. Having him was the equivalent of nearly 6,500 flights to Paris. You could have flown 90 times a year, there and back nearly every week of your life, and still not have the same impact on the planet as his birth had.
Yeah, but I don't think...
Not to mention the pesticides, detergents, the huge quantity of plastics, the nuclear fuels used to keep him warm. His birth was a selfish act. It was brutal. You have condemned others to suffering. In fact, if you really cared, what you'd do is cut his throat open right now.
Excuse me.
Or I could do it for you. I could take out my knife, make an incision in his neck, walk away. I'd get my coach over there, and you would have done more than your bit for the future of humanity. I could do it now. But look at me chatting. I think they're about to leave. I hope he gets over that flu. But maybe he just shouldn't.
That might just be the most perfect 3 minutes of television I have ever seen. It encapsulates an awful lot of what's wrong with what you might call the architecture of humanity, the hypocrisy of armchair environmentalists, the human exceptionalism that underlies pretty much all of our interactions with any species other than our own, the cognitive biases, kin selection in this case, that exist for trivially obvious evolutionary reasons, but which now threaten the survival of about 100,000 species per year. Pretty much the only complaint I have with this clip is that it actually drastically understates by perhaps an order of magnitude the actual amount of ecological havoc that child will inflict on the planet if his throat does not get cut. Now, I don't have to tell any of you that we are killing off the current biosphere. Climate change is the environmental flavor of the week. So I will be focusing on climate change at the front end of this talk, but keep in mind that I am only citing it as a case study, not so much a problem in its own right as a symptom of a much deeper problem rooted in our own biology. I begin by harping on our environmental sins because I want to drive home just how much damage, how much danger, how profound an ecological threat. Our brains are capable of ignoring, thanks to faulty wiring. And of course, the thing is, climate change is only one of a host of injuries we're inflicting on the planet. Only 3% of the world's ecosystems remain intact. We have wiped out over half the world's wildlife just since the 70s, nearly half, 47% of natural ecosystems during the same period. Simple overfishing. Back around the turn of the century, I read a paper in Science claiming that we'd already wiped out 80 to 90% of the world's commercial fish stocks, and that was 20 years ago. Climate change has only had a minor impact on any of these things. Mostly it's us just directly killing animals and destroying their habitat. Now, these alarming little graphics don't even mention insects, but they're crashing worldwide too. In parts of Europe, you've got documented declines as high as 90%. Even in wilderness protection areas, nature parks in Costa Rica, for example, declines have been as high as 70%. Now we lose the insects, we can pretty much kiss the whole biosphere goodbye as we know it. And yet, nobody even really noticed what was going on with these guys until about 10 years ago. I mean, who cares about a bunch of bugs, right? This is a real-time ticker at the Museum of Natural History in Tel Aviv. I visited a couple of years ago in mid-December, so close to the end of the year. And if you look closely, you will see that we are wiping out, best guess, nearly 130,000 species every year. Now, that is admittedly a high-end estimate. I have seen other estimates of global extinction as low as 70,000 species a year. So, you know, if you think that reflects better on us as a species, by all means, knock yourselves out, embrace the lower number. Either way, with climate change kicking into high gear these days, we are only just getting started. And yeah, but COVID changed all that, right? It significantly reduced carbon emissions for a year. It taught us that we could pull together and make radical changes in our lifestyle when we really had to. Nature began to heal itself, even if these pictures of dolphins, presumably in Venice, turned out to be completely fake. We're using this crisis as an opportunity, the story is going, where we've got governments around the world committing to carbon neutrality like never before. Trump is out, Biden's in. Biden is as green can be, right? Now, all this hopeful rhetoric actually sounds great until you realize that Biden is actively, albeit quietly, still backing Trump-era fossil projects. Most recently, pipeline to carry oil down from Canada's own tar sands, which is widely regarded as one of the dirtiest fossil mega projects on the planet, until you realize that the post-pandemic economic recovery is being powered mainly by coal, that carbon emissions are not only set to increase again this year, but the increase is turning out to be the second largest jump in history, and that even if all the world's nations meet their new and improved carbon neutrality goals, the planet is still going to heat up by 2.4 degrees centigrade. Now, one relevant metric here: the world's coral reefs are effectively gone before we hit two. Another recent research has shown that 2 degrees could be enough to push both the Greenland and West Antarctic ice sheets past the point of no return. That's basically a 13-meter rise in sea levels right there. Now, here's a series of carbon trajectories leading to the end of the century. And I haven't checked, but I assume you guys can see my mouse cursor here. This is the trajectory we are currently on. And you can see that COVID really hasn't changed that very much. This is where we are headed if we meet all of our come to Jesus post-COVID commitments. This is where we are headed if we essentially want to aspire to a best case scenario of global environmental disaster, quite frankly. And this is where we're headed if we want to aspire to widespread global catastrophe. That's 1.5 degrees and 2.0 degrees respectively. Except these latter two estimates come out of a 2018 report that proved to be far too optimistic. I will get into that in a bit. So even basically at this point, 1.5 is probably going to lead to catastrophe, but I wouldn't worry too much about the consequences at 1.5, because according to a recent paper in Nature, there is now only a 5% chance of keeping warming even down to 2 degrees, even if every government in the world pulls up its socks and keeps all of their current commitments. We should also not forget the fact that, you know, for all the benefit COVID's had, it's not itself really a natural event. Most recent events, outbreaks have been zoonotic, as they come from animals. Zika, Ebola, SARS, AIDS, bird flu, to name a few. And where do these animals live? Well, they live in the forests that we are busy mowing down for building materials, for subdivisions, for agriculture, for the sheer perverse joy of owning the libtards if you're Donald Trump or Jair Bolsonaro. Now look at these figures here. Pretty clearly, the lower the forest cover, the greater the number of outbreaks. Fun fact is that tropical deforestation in 2020 was actually 12% greater than it was in 2019, despite a global pandemic which should by rights have radically reduced demand for wood products. So even in the throes of one pandemic, we cannot seem to help but sow the seeds for others. Put that together with the fact that any new pathogen can cross the globe now in the time it takes to hitch a ride on an airplane, and that thanks to a warming world, pathogens and parasites can now survive at latitudes that would have killed them before. We're expecting malaria in the Baltic by 2050. They've already recorded person-to-person transmission of dengue fever in New York City. And you have a world in which the incidence of emerging diseases has more than quadrupled since 1970. Also a world where only 1% of wildlife viruses are thought to have even been identified, much less countered. Now this graph, what little you can see of it in front of the thumbnails of you all, this graph shows the number of outbreaks per year over time, over the past 50, 60 years in the Asia Pacific region, but it's probably a decent microcosm of the global picture in general. Monkeypox has just raised its head in England, for example. Boris Johnson assures us we have absolutely nothing to worry about. Loss of biodiversity plays a role here too. When we ravage an ecosystem, the species that tend to survive are, you know, by definition, the tough, weedy ones, rats, mosquitoes, for example, which not only survive, but they increase their numbers as they expand into niches formerly occupied by all those candy-ass species that couldn't hack human impact. And wouldn't you know it, it's these weedy species that also happen to be disproportionately good at transmitting disease. So climate change causes drought, drought results in increased rodent populations, pneumonic plague kicks off a comeback tour. If not plague, Henra virus, if not Henra, West Nile, babiosis, anaplumosis, Nipah. Now here is a scary little fucker. Original reservoir for Nipah was in bats, but it jumped to humans via pigs. Back in 1998, it infected 276 people in a town in Malaysia. It killed 106 of them. That's a 38% kill rate. That's higher than smallpox. Nipah's been kind of on an intermittent tour throughout Bangladesh and Malaysia ever since. It's been racking up local kill rates as high as 90%. Half the cases are now transmitted human to human, so there's no need for any kind of animal vector anymore. There is no cure. But again, this is not just about pandemics. It's not just about climate change. It's about emptying the oceans. It's about strip mining the seabeds, cutting down the forests. It's about hormone disruptors and plastics and insect pollinators, cratering and fast forward. It's about an economic system so out of touch with reality that actually treats human beings as rational players, which accords zero value to oxygen and clean water and zero cost to mine tailings in a river. This is what we are. We cannot seem to stop. It's almost as though there's something inside of us that keeps us from paying attention. Now, you may dismiss a lot of this as alarmist hyperbole, and really that's to be expected. People far more expert than I have taken way more shit for raising the alarm. People shat all over David Wallace Wells back in 2017 when he put out The Uninhabitable Earth, which claimed that even what the scientists had been telling us was a soft sell, and that no matter what we did, large parts of this planet will be uninhabitable to humans by the end of the century. Now, the critics could not find much to fault with the facts that he cited. So they settled for calling him out for being too depressing, too defeatist. You know, you have to give people hope. You need to stop pounding the doomsday drum and start inspiring instead, or people will give in to a paralyzing narrative of doom and hopelessness is one of Michael Mann, climate scientist Michael Mann's favorite lines. Then the 2018 IPCC report came out. You all remember that. And it made Wallace Wells look like an optimist. It confirmed that global environmental disaster was now our best case scenario. And that even to achieve that, we'd have to go through this whole litany of accomplishments that you already know about by now. Cut carbon emissions by 50% by the end of this decade. Guess how much progress we have made on that front. Go totally neutral by 2050. Also, we have to cut global meat and dairy consumption by 90%. If we accomplish these and even more Herculean tasks, then we'll only lose, you know, up to 90% of the world's remaining coral reefs instead of losing them all. Only 350 million more urban dwellers will be exposed to, quote, deadly heat events. Only 130 to 140 million will be inundated by rising seas. Fish stocks in low latitudes, they're still totally kaput. But we might be able to save some of the higher latitude populations. You get the idea. Now, that was if we limited global temperature increases to 1.5. Remember, even if the politicians keep every one of their COVID-inspired come to Greta promises, we are still on the road to 2.4 by the end of this century. Interestingly, Shell and BP are expecting increases of 3 to 5 degrees, not by the end of the century, but by the middle. And keep in mind also that nobody's saying temperatures are going to rise 3 to 5 degrees and then just stop. They're going to raise, they're going to go up by that much and then just keep on climbing. It's just, you know, nobody really bothered to follow the trajectory past 2100 because, you know, honestly, what's the point? But then it turned out that the 2018 IPCC report was really childishly optimistic. It did not account for the massive rolling pandemics that were going to start hollowing out our urban centers in about, you know, 2 years ago now. Didn't account for methane release from the permafrost, which would be enough to boost Arctic temperatures by 5 degrees by century's end, even if we cut all our emissions tomorrow, because we're on track to pass a methane tipping point. Didn't even touch on the waste heat generated by mining cryptocurrency and blockchain operations, which one study suggests is enough to add 2 degrees to the global budget all by itself within the decade. Didn't mention the fact that ocean bottom trawling, think clear-cutting forests, but it's under the water, so nobody really notices or cares. Bottom trawling contributes as much carbon into the system as the entire global air travel industry. Also, these reports tend to focus on direct temperature effects, so they tend to be conservative. So we haven't mentioned downstream deaths due to social unrest, the forced migration of environmental refugees, food shortages due to the overfishing, ocean acidification. We have not mentioned that the world's arable land will be completely exhausted by 2050. They used to say we had until 2070. That proved to be too optimistic. Haven't mentioned that nasty mutant strain of wheat rust you've probably never heard of that's currently creeping around the Middle East and the Med. It's resistant to all known fungicides. Some people say it could conceivably take out the world's wheat crop within a decade. We haven't talked about downstream economic collapse. 500 million people depend on those soon to be extinct coral reefs for their livelihood, for example. But the hope police have not given up. Just a couple of months back, the Australian Academy of Science released this report claiming that meeting 1.5 was now virtually impossible, which really should be obvious to anybody with eyes and an internet connection. But sure enough, usual suspects piled on complaining about hyperbole and the need to inspire to action, not frighten into despair. Michael Mann pointed out that keeping us to 1.5 was still permitted by the laws of physics, which is as if physics was ever really the bottleneck here. Others said that the report was really first rate, except for that phrase, virtually impossible. Like, couldn't we swap it out for extremely difficult or extraordinarily challenging instead? The thing is, it doesn't make much sense to shoot the messenger and demand can-do optimism when the optimists keep turning out to be wrong and the pessimists keep turning out to be too optimistic. 3 years ago, the entire Greenland ice shelf started melting across its entire upper surface. That was not supposed to happen until 2070. The Canadian permafrost has already thawed to a greater depth than that which was predicted for 2090. This paper came out in Nature a year or so ago. Turns out flooding due to sea level rise is now going to be 3 times worse than our previous worst case projections. And this just in, a few days back, somebody leaked a draft of next year's IPCC report to the press. Want to guess what it says? People do not want to know this. And the worse the real world gets, the more strident the whole happy face movement becomes. Even science fiction writers like myself are being hectored to lighten up. We've literally been ordered to stop writing dystopias and start writing hope punk instead. That's what they call it, hope punk. As though wishful thinking is somehow radical and edgy, as though rose-colored glasses are some act of subversive rebellion. President of Arizona State University has even blamed science fiction writers for the withering of the NASA space program. Because apparently all those NASA scientists were inspired by Star Trek visions of a hopeful utopian future. Once we started getting real, they lost their will to dream big. Now, ironically, most of the solutions the optimists are presenting dream too big. Even that IPCC report's least catastrophic case 1.5 degree increase scenario, that hinges on building machines to suck carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and scaling them up to the point where they can have world-changing effects within a couple of decades. Now, of course, the simple act of going carbon neutral can be accomplished using technology that we have today. I mean, the price of solar and wind have dropped something like 90% over the past decade. But carbon removal, sucking back all that CO2 we've already dumped into the atmosphere, that's basically unicorn tech. It does exist. There's this experimental plant in Iceland that sucks CO2 out of the air and locks it into the limestone. It's really cool technology. But last I checked, it could only convert about 50 tons of CO2 per year. Humanity's current carbon emissions are around 37 billion metric tons per year. So you would have to scale this Iceland factory up by 624 million times just to balance out our emissions in real time without making the slightest dent in the backlog. And yet sucking up all that past carbon somehow is the only way we can look forward to mere worldwide disaster. We are basing our hopes basically on an unfounded faith in infant technology coupled with a pathological insistence that we just stay positive. We are simultaneously the most intelligent and the most delusionally stupid species on the planet. Now, as it turns out, there are good evolutionary reasons for this, because up until recently, delusional stupidity was kind of a survival trait. This is one of my favorite quotes. Brains are not truth detectors. As Steven Pinker said in, what was it? How the Mind Works, I think. Brains are survival engines. They were shaped by natural selection. They are wired to promote fitness. If believing a lie helped you spread your genes over the course of our evolutionary history, then today your brain is likely to believe that lie with all of its furry little heart. And the obvious biggie when it comes to these drives is family values. My genes are the most special. My child is the best thing ever. Nothing is more important than my family. Guy I know wanted to get his daughters vaccinated against COVID. So we got this special deal, took them across the border to Scarborough, handed them special forms that claimed they worked for a company called, I kid you not, The Matrix. And he told them that if anyone asked about their place of employment, they were supposed to lie. Now, to their credit, his daughters were kind of squipped out by this. It was obviously cheating. They ended up being the only two white people in the room. This particular vac site had been run for frontline folks most vulnerable to infection, who disproportionately tend to be people of color for reasons we all know about by now. Anyhow, they called their dad out on this. It was unethical, deprived two other people of protection, although they did go ahead and get the shot. Anyhow, dad's response was, I'm just trying to protect my family. When you've got kids of your own, you'll understand. Now, I heard this story and I thought, is there a single evil perpetrated by human beings that doesn't start from this very rationale? I'm protecting those that are dear to me. Me and mine come first. Cheating is okay as long as it serves our interest. Everything from shoplifting to genocide has its seeds ultimately in selfish genes. And dad was playing it as a get out of jail card because sure, he cheated, but he did it for family. And that not only made it okay, it made it morally praiseworthy somehow, obligatory even. We have taking kin selection, an act of utter Darwinian selfishness, and we have lipsticked it onto something altruistic and noble, the very hallmark of the good human being. How often have you heard the sentiment, nothing is more important than family? When you have heard it, has anybody ever disagreed? Family values is the very bedrock of Western so-called morality, even if family values are destroying the planet. Now, the irony is, those people demanding that we stop being all doom and gloom and start talking about solutions are strangely silent when it comes to solutions that are staring us in the face. We could do so much to help the environment if we just chose not to breed. 90% of the mammalian biomass on this planet is us and our livestock. 96%. Only 4% of the world's mammals actually live in an ecosystem. We first worlders stamp a Godzilla-sized blueprint on the world every time we reproduce. I could fly back and forth across the Atlantic every week and my carbon footprint still wouldn't come close to the annual impact of having even a single child. Whole punks never seem to bring that up. In fact, some people even cite more human reproduction as some kind of bizarro solution. And it's not just brain-dead Republicans like Mike Lee saying this. A few months before COVID locked us down, the author of one of those stop writing dystopia screeds I screen capped a few slides back, well-regarded leftist progressive woman I have known for years, stood in my kitchen and told me with a straight face that the solution to the world's problems was having more kids, because that means you'd have more brains working on the problem. You won't just be churning out millions more carbon belchers who grew up sitting on the couch playing Xbox and snarfing pork rinds until the ceiling crashes in. No, you'll be raising a new generation full of hope and ideas that could save the world in about, I don't know, 25, 35 years, assuming anyone's still alive by then. Even facing imminent environmental apocalypse due to the weight of our own consumption, the unrestricted ability to make even more of us, somehow considered not just some kind of alienable right, but a duty to the future, to the point where if you choose not to have kids, you will find yourself the subject of derogatory opinion pieces in leading mainstream newspapers. Now, fortunately, and here is some good news for a change, having more babies is becoming increasingly difficult. Human sperm counts are plummeting. They've been plummeting since World War II, thanks to all the contaminants we have been pumping into the environment. And they're saying that by 2045, most of us will need artificial assistance if we want to reproduce. So who knows, if this keeps up, maybe the earth does heal itself. We go the way of the dodo. But it won't be because we've seen the light or suddenly developed a sense of proportion. It'll be because we were too stupid to care about the downstream effects of our own technology, so they turned around and bit us in the ass. And that is the real point of what I'm talking about here. I'm not talking about how to save the world. I'm not even arguing that we can't or shouldn't try. I'm citing the Anthropocene as a case in point to illustrate what's wrong with us as a species and what will continue to be wrong with us even if we do manage to save the planet this time. So, onward, family values, the selfish primacy of kin selection. Now, that plays a major role in digging the hole we find ourselves in today, but you would also think that caring for your kids might entail caring what kind of world they grew up in. So, why hasn't family values inspired us to clean up our act for the sake of our own kin? Here's one reason. Give somebody a choice of $10 today or $20 in 2 weeks. And most of the time, they'll choose the smaller immediate payoff. Now, the technical term for this is hyperbolic discounting, and it actually makes a lot of sense in unpredictable environments because, you know, who knows, a lot can happen in 2 weeks. Guy who promised you the money could get hit by a bus for something. But the flip side of this is that the further off something is in time, the less real it becomes to us. And this makes it almost impossible to really internalize long-term consequences. We can imagine long-term consequences intellectually. We imagine, you know, sapient, smart-ass raccoons with gun fetishes in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. We do that for fun. But we don't really believe that stuff, not down in the gut where it makes all our real decisions. We literally don't even believe in our own mortality. This paper came out a couple of years ago. They found a kind of a a denial switch that throws the brain into neutral when the subject of your own death comes up. You can internalize other people's deaths, just not your own. So it's really not surprising that even now, when you give someone a choice between an even slightly lower standard of living today and absolute environmental disaster in 20 years, they'll almost always opt for environmental disaster because it's 20 years away, because someone will probably come up with something. 20 years away just isn't as real to people as the immediate trauma of having to give up a couple of lattes a week. Your ability to do math is compromised by your political ideology. Did you know that? Someone can show you the results of a study on some hot button issue. They can give you a look at the data that went into it. And if the results support your political beliefs, you will be able to interpret those results just fine. But if the study contradicts your ideological beliefs, your capacity to interpret those results will drop to the level of a statistical illiterate. Now, I'm not saying that you see the results and reject them as a Chinese hoax or something, although of course that does happen a lot too. This is more pernicious. You see the results and you literally can't interpret them correctly, even though you would have had no trouble interpreting the exact same numbers if they supported your beliefs. Religion. Now, empirically, most religious beliefs are utter nonsense. And yet, religious communities tend to survive longer than secular ones, other things being equal, because empirical truth doesn't matter. The point is survival and inclusive fitness. And to a social species like ours, your odds of success are maximized by having a strong support network. Basically, you do not make friends by telling them that their deeply cherished beliefs are bullshit. I mean, so what if it's true? Truth is not the survival trait here, conformity is. Religion promotes social cohesion, so it prevails. The point here is that climate change deniers, creationists, anti-vaxxers, they're not necessarily deranged. Their brains are doing pretty much what our brains are doing, what brains are supposed to be doing. It's just that most of us have completely the wrong idea of what brains are for. Now, there are literally hundreds of these cognitive biases wired into our heads. They were all adaptive at some point. Some of them still are. They all helped us to survive. But also, by definition, they distort and bias your view of reality. Every one of these biases helps you survive by lying to you. So you've got an interesting choice here. You can either have a clear, unbiased view of the world, or you can value your life. You can have objectivity, or you can have survival drives. You can't optimize along both those axes simultaneously. Remember that. I am going to come back to it. So, you know, don't blame capitalism for this mess, tempting as that is. Don't blame religion. These are just formalized delivery platforms for greed and fear. They're basically an overlaid interface for something deeper. The problem is human nature. Biologically, we are enthralled to a suite of gut feelings that urge us to act on their impulses and ignore the consequences, because to the gut, the future just isn't real. We watch ourselves destroying the world. We know on some level we really should stop, but somehow we never get around to it. Even now, on a continent plagued by droughts, firestorms, crop failures, heat waves, floods, and plagues, every one of these headlines was taken within the past week, by the way, almost three quarters of the US population says they're not even alarmed about climate change. The world does not need fixing. We do. Now, believe it or not, there are people out there who can help us show us how to fix ourselves, people whose neurology already diverges from ours, who see things differently, people whose priorities and perceptions are in closer accord to reality. And we have a term for these people. We say they are brain damaged. For example, most parents would rescue their children from a burning building. Given a choice between rescuing your kid and rescuing someone else's, probably opt for your own kid because kin selection, right? Family values. But if you injure their brains just so, if you induce a lesion along the ventral medial prefrontal cortex, suddenly this whole kin thing drops out of the picture. Folks thus lesioned would, at least according to this paper in Nature, unhesitatingly leave their own child to burn if that meant they could save two or more strangers. Now, these people are not sociopaths. They still have a sense of right and wrong. And in fact, it's a better sense than ours because it is based on rational ethics instead of gut morality. They do not happen to think that their babies are the center of the world. They will choose the greater good, even at the cost of their own fitness. And you can see why a trait like that would never take off under the auspices of natural selection. There is another class of person who has a disproportionately accurate handle on reality. They're better than the rest of us at figuring out how much control they really have over local events with unknown variables. They're better than we are at assessing their own performance on assigned tasks. We normal folk, we tend to take credit for good things that happen to us. Something bad happens, we tend to look for somebody else to blame. These other folks, though, they are far more balanced in their outlook. When faced with exactly the same test scenarios, they tend to apportion blame and credit and without that kind of self-serving bias. And we have a term for these people, too. We call them clinically depressed. We regard them as a bunch of unmotivated Debbie Downers who always look on the dark side. And yet, when tested empirically, their so-called glum and hopeless worldviews are, in fact, more accurate than the self-serving ego boost the rest of us experience. Now you can see why we would be built this way. In a world full of predators and disease and high mortality, which is to say most of our evolutionary history, anyone with a truly realistic view of their chances would probably just curl up and wait to die. They would succumb, as Michael Mann likes to say, to a paralyzing narrative of gloom and despair. Hence that mortality denial circuit I mentioned a few minutes back. Healthy humans are programmed for delusional optimism, not because we're actually going to be Mad Max, but because it benefits our chances just a little if we think we are. It even kind of works. People who believe that they have free will, that they're in charge of their own destiny, tend to do better on midterms, for example, than people who know better. Natural selection promotes hope, even if it is completely unfounded. Perhaps there is no stronger indictment of human delusionalism, if that's even a word, than the fact that we describe our most objective individuals as victims of a pathology. And this is why I have so little patience for hope punk, by the way. It's why I roll my eyes when people like Guillermo del Toro declare in Time magazine that optimism is the radical option. Bullshit. Optimism is the default option. It is so deeply ingrained in us that it threatens our survival as a civilization right now. Parkinson's disease. You want to know something good about Parkinson's disease? It loses your religion. People with Parkinson's are significantly less religious. It's as though the disease neutralizes those parts of the brain involved in the religious experience. There are a few of those. The temporal lobe, the left prefrontal cortex, McNamara et al. Implicate the dopamine networks along the front of the brain. Now, not too many rational people would complain about a malady that reduced religiosity. We are, after all, talking about belief systems which historically have not only fought scientific progress tooth and nail, but which have also provided cover for every kind of prejudice right up to genocide and holy war. Here in Canada, we are currently in the process of discovering the unmarked graves of over 1,000 Indigenous children and counting, killed by the Catholic school residential system. The Catholic Church easily meets the definition of a terrorist organization under Canadian law, although honestly, I don't expect that to happen anytime soon. But if we could tweak the pathogen behind Parkinson's, if we could re-engineer it so that it targets only the centers of religious belief while leaving the rest of the brain alone, that might go a long way to making our species less congenitally stupid and hopefully less destructive. You all know about dopamine. It's like the superstar of the neurotransmitters. This is the root of everything from orgasm to addiction. It's what drives us to consume. This is why slot machines work. And dopamine is widely described as a pleasure molecule, but it's more accurate to call it a motivation molecule. Dopamine makes you seek rewards. Dopamine is greed. It is the pursuit of more stuff. Now this is nociceptin. Nociceptin is a neuropeptide that does a whole bunch of things, but what made me prick up my ears in this context is that apparently it acts like kind of the anti-dopamine. If dopamine is, I'm driven by greed, nociceptin is, fuck it, I give up. The system that generates it is right down here in an area they call the ventral tegmental area. So sometimes I wonder if nociceptin, with a tweak or two, might be kind of an antidote for greed. If we can induce this, maybe hack the system so our brains start overproducing this stuff, maybe enough will finally be enough. People who have three yachts won't suffer existential crises if their neighbor has five. They'll stop caring if they even have any yachts. Interestingly, nociceptin can also induce, can also induce depression, which most regard as an unfortunate side effect. I choose to regard it as a feature, not a bug, given that depressed is just another way of saying more realistic. Anyway, these are just a few of the ways we might edit the neurology of humanity 1.0 and upgrade it to, say, humanity 1.5, a more enlightened, less selfish, more sustainable version of ourselves. And of course, right now it's totally blue sky. As far as I know, nobody's conducted any serious research into this premise. Even if someone wanted to, I can't imagine it would be much fun getting funding. I mean, please give me a couple million dollars so I can find out how to rewire human nature at the neurochemical level. Don't even get me started on wide-scale implementation. So I cite these examples not to claim that we're going to do any of this anytime soon, but as potential starting points for a longer-term upgrade. In the short term, climate change is humanity 1.0's problem. We could conceivably beat it still, I think, although it's not looking good. But in the long run, climate change isn't the problem. We had a nuclear arms race that almost wiped us out before anybody had ever heard of climate change. Afterwards, who knows? We could have a gray goo nanotech scenario or an AI hard singularity takeoff, or we could just collapse the world's ecosystems by paving them all over. Solving any of these individual crises will only buy us time until the next one. And the way we're wired now, driven by short-term greed and long-term blindness, you can be damn sure we will create a next one. So ultimately, I think the way to really save humanity is to turn it into something else. And that is a long-term project. So everything from here on out is long-term. The rest of this talk is predicated on the assumption that we as a species survive long enough to seriously contemplate interstellar travel as a feasible option. I'm admitting freely up front, this is a delusionally optimistic premise, but you know, I'm a human being. I'm just wired that way. I am a prisoner of my inner drives. Now, interplanetary travel is already front and center, of course. People like Musk and Hawking back in the day, I always figured that if we destroyed this world, we could always move to some other one. They basically argued that we had to colonize Mars in order to avoid extinction. Now, Musk does not, to my knowledge, address the fact that the most likely cause of human extinction is human behavior, and that's going to be the one thing we'll be bringing along with us no matter what planet we end up on. He seems more worried about robot uprising for some reason. Still, for what it's worth, I think we could be on Mars before long. The super rich will be on Mars anyway. They'll probably end up colonizing the whole damn solar system if civilization does not collapse first. What then? Well, I told you we're going to get speculative here. Then we reach for the stars, which is way tougher. The time scales, the logistical problems, the technological demands, and the risks are exponentially greater. Now, assuming nobody develops a warp drive in the foreseeable future, there are two ways to go interstellar. You can go fast or you can go slow. If you go slow, it takes you centuries to get anywhere. And that means either generation ships or hibernation. Generation ship, if you don't know, is basically a propelled city in space. It's outfitted with an onboard ecosystem that keeps hundreds or thousands of people alive for hundreds or thousands of years. People whose descendants we really hope will still be on board with the program started by their great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandparents a few years before, a few centuries before. There are innumerable possible failure points for such a mission. Speaking just to the ecosystem component and as a form of biologist, let me say that I would only send my kids on such a journey if I really didn't like them very much. Also, if I had kids. Now, hibernation is a lot simpler, and it's much closer to realization. You can reduce metabolism by 90% just by sticking hydrogen sulfide into your breathing mix. But even a crew metabolizing at 10% is going to put a heavy load on life support system over hundreds of years. Also, this does not get mentioned a lot, but cosmic radiation damages DNA. It does it right here on Earth, too. So hibernators would arrive at their destinations with shredded genomes. In other words, they would be dead. Or they would have to wake up periodically en route to allow their own cellular repair mechanisms to fix the damage. Or they would have to ship out loaded down with layers and layers of lead or depleted uranium or whatnot as shielding. All of which, of course, increases mass, increases life support demands, increases travel time. Now, you could try going faster. I mean, you get close enough to life speed, and time dilation allows you to cross the whole galaxy in just a few years, subjectively anyway. But the faster you go, the harder you run into atoms of interstellar hydrogen. Now, they're not a problem at lower speeds. There's only like one or two of them per cubic centimeter. But before you're even halfway to light speed, they will be blue shifted enough to literally melt your ship on impact, long, long before you reach enough of a speed to get any kind of benefit from time dilation. Now, all of these problems, they come down to mass, obviously, the cost of moving all that meat and all the equipment needed to keep it alive. And the obvious solution is to lose the meat. You save yourself all that shielding and food and water and air. You save yourself the life support equipment. You strip away all that hardware that forces you to accelerate skyscrapers into space. You send electrons instead. You digitize yourself. A personality upload is pretty popular in transhumanist circles, as far as I can tell. For the most part, I've never really bought into it myself. A lot of transhumanists don't seem to have internalized the fact that even if we do figure out how to upload a personality, it most likely won't be a transfer. It'll basically be a copy paste, probably with a delete original tacked on at the end. And as the original being deleted, I would not be entirely on board with that. However, way back in the 1980s, a dude called Hans Moravec posited an upload scenario I could probably get behind. He asks us to imagine a meat brain being replaced by silicon, one neuron at a time. At what point do you stop being human? He wondered, when the last neuron is swapped out? When half the brain is gone, when you lose that last bit of meat, there is a continuity to this process that sort of soothes my visceral gut fears, that makes me realize that if you change gradually enough, one neuron at a time, you never stop being you in any real sense. So I have come to grudgingly admit that mind uploading, again, assuming it's even possible, is not something that we would reject out of hand. It might even become popular. Once that happens, the cost of interstellar travel becomes almost trivial because you are moving a much smaller payload. Spaceships, not the size of a skyscraper, but the size of an iPhone, much like those the Starshot Initiative is working on building, even as we speak, to get to the Centauri system. Now, this vastly increases the speeds you can attain, but rapid transit isn't such a big thing anymore because you can also amble along slowly with your system clock turned way down, so that to the digitized beings living on the motherboard, centuries pass like moments. And if you absolutely have to indulge your brainstem expansionist tendencies, fine. Bring along the specs for building organic beings, print them from raw materials at the other end when you find a suitable world. In fact, sending digital facsimiles between stars would be so much cheaper and easier than sending meat that it might be reasonable to assume that any starfaring species faced with the same laws of physics will end up going the digital route. Now, maybe I'm not telling you anything new. I at least have been reading stories about digitized people in tiny Coke can spaceships since before the turn of the century. But take it one step further. With digitization, you gain the potential not just to upload your brain, but to edit it. So I'm basically talking about turning ourselves into a new cognitive species. And we do that by getting rid of the brainstem legacy programming. And I mean, why not? Those survival instincts served us well back when we were at the mercy of our environment, when we were kept in check by disease and starvation and predators. But now really the environment is at our mercy. Now we are at the mercy of our instincts. They're really more threat than benefit, as anybody who can look outside basically should be able to confirm. So if we're going to go to the stars, or I suppose rather if the rich tech bros are going to go to the stars and leave us all behind, we're talking about a whole new scenario. Because if you can upload into silicon anyway, why not get rid of all those nasty cognitive biases? Why just copy when you can optimize? We already have some really promising avenues to explore thanks to Parkinson's and nociceptin and their friends. And you wouldn't even have to deal with that gut level revulsion most of us would feel at the prospect of changing what you are, that desire to protect the self. I mean, nobody's going to volunteer to cut out their own brainstem, but, you know, editing a copy of yourself? Why not? For science. And you might say that would strip away all the things that make us human. And I say we'd be doing the opposite. We would be stripping away all those things that make us mammals, that make us vertebrates. The exclusively human part is what we would leave intact. And you might also say, wait a second, that whole brainstem thing, that's all about survival. Without those instincts, we wouldn't actually care whether we lived or died. And my answer to that is, yeah, so what? Now, I'm not arguing against survival here. I wouldn't expect you to buy into it if I did, because your brainstem won't let you. But even if you adhere to the idea that our survival is a good thing, something to be pursued, dragging a bunch of feces-hurling tribalistic monkey instincts across the galaxy is not necessarily the best way to achieve that goal. They compromise rational thought in a wide number of ways, and they might not be necessary. Spread our digitized selves widely enough, and nothing short of a galaxy-wide catastrophe could take us out. And when you measure those odds against the risks posed by dragging our own caveman instincts into the future with us, it is not clear to me that keeping the brainstem is the safer alternative. Now, like the laws of physics, the laws of natural selection are probably universal. And that means that any aliens out there will almost certainly have evolved the same short-sighted survival drives that we are afflicted with here on Earth. Once they have developed advanced technology, they, just like us, will have to wrestle with the destructive potential of those instincts. That's one of the great filters commonly proposed to explain the Fermi paradox. In fact, we haven't seen any aliens because they all lost that struggle, wiped themselves out. But if they manage to pass through that filter, if they survive long enough to contemplate interstellar travel, then they'll encounter the same mass energy constraints that we will. So these are my two postulates. First, all technological civilizations go through a crisis phase in which primitive cognitive processes designed for short-term local situations influence the use of advanced technologies that have global long-term impacts. Deprecation of those primitive impulses will be vital to species survival. And secondly, by necessity, starfaring civilizations will have achieved the ability to copy individual minds into digital formats. So think of point number one as a filter and point number two as a bottleneck. I'm not calling them axioms, obviously, because they are very arguable. We don't even know if mind uploading is possible, even in principle. But if these two conditions are met, I think it might be possible to classify starfaring civilizations along the same lines kind of that Nikolai Kardashev did. Don't know how many of you are familiar with the Kardashev scale. It basically classifies civilizations according to their energy consumption. Type one can harness all the energy available to its planet. Type two can harness all the energy generated by its star, basically your Dyson sphere civilization. Type three controls the energy output of an entire galaxy. Now, my Moravec metric, on the other hand, is an index not of energy use, but of cognitive modification. And I have come up with four stages. The first is the brain stems, naturally evolved organic beings like us. They are constrained by both the filter and the bottleneck, so they're both limited to a single solar system and in constant danger of self-destruction because apocalyptic machinery is being run by caveman brains. Next is the uploaded. These are digitized organic minds. They're uploaded, but they're not edited. So they pass through the bottleneck, but not the filter. Caveman brains, basically, with interstellar flight capabilities. They can spread out through the universe fine, but their brain stems are always lurking off stage to screw things up. I suspect this is kind of an optional stage. By the time we can digitize minds, we will doubtless also have the ability to edit those constructs. So assuming we don't viscerally recoil on some moral grounds at the prospect of changing human nature, we might skip this one entirely and move right on to the modified. Now, these are uploaded, edited minds. They got past the bottleneck, making progress on the filter. Perhaps they keep their instincts around to keep them sharp in matters of survival and persistence, but they've dialed them back. So the brainstem acts more of as an advisor than a master. They are basically what we only pretend to be. They are in control of their instincts. And, you know, maybe we'll stop there. Looks like a good place to stop to me, but I have pulled one more phase out of my ass just in case, and I call them the purified. They have passed through both the bottleneck and the filter. They've dispensed with the brainstem entirely. The modified have learned to control their instincts. The purified have no instincts to control. And since instincts, by definition, exist to promote the spread of selfish genes, these beings are selfless. They are not driven to fight or compete for resources. They may still possess a sort of curiosity, insofar as curiosity isn't a purely brainstem phenomenon, may even still be capable of pleasure. Not all pleasure responses derive from the basement. It turns out we also have one in the orbital frontal cortex. It's apparently associated with high-level analysis and decision-making. Apparently, we literally get off on solving puzzles. So the purified might enjoy continuing to exist as long as there are mysteries to explore. But if not, you know, no big deal. They've seen the universe through clear eyes. They have made that choice. Now, these are beings which, quite simply, have no needs. They are divorced from natural selection. If they survive, it's not because they struggle. It's because they are too cosmopolitan, they're too ubiquitous to be vulnerable to extinction-level events. In Darwinian terms, the purified don't even qualify as life forms anymore. Now, the catch is they might not qualify as conscious beings either. It really all depends on the role of the brainstem in generating consciousness. Now, we've known for years that it plays some role. For one thing, there are those rare and unfortunate souls born without, pardon me, any cortical structures. Anencephalic, we call them, basically nothing but fluid sloshing around where the cerebral hemisphere should be. And they show all the hallmarks of consciousness with nothing but a brainstem to run that program on. Not to mention the wide number of vertebrates out there, the fish and the reptiles that have basically never had anything more than a brainstem and seem to do just fine. But now Mark Solms, a neuroscientist out of South Africa, he argues in this book that consciousness consists, by definition, of feelings. There's a bit of a tautology here in that you can't have a feeling without feeling it, which implies some level of subjective awareness, but I think that's actually kind of his point. And feelings, according to Solms, are a kind of categorical distillation of various needs the organism has to juggle in order to stay alive. We organisms have a number of survival priorities at any given time, but obviously we cannot attend to all of them simultaneously. You can't feed and sleep at the same time, for example. You can't simultaneously copulate and run from a predator, at least not in my experience. So the brain has to juggle all these competing demands, figure out its priorities, and the bottom line manifests itself as a feeling. You feel hungry until you see the lion stalking you from the grass, at which point you forget all about hunger, and you feel fear instead. It's not that your stomach has suddenly gotten full. It's just that your priorities have changed. Now, Solms names the periaqueductal gray as the calculator that balances these variables and comes up with a feeling. And the periaqueductal gray is right here in the brainstem. Well, his bottom line is that consciousness is the manifestation of feeling. Feelings exist as a manifestation of need. Need exists only to ensure survival. So if Soames is right, you don't get consciousness without a survival drive. Now, for what it's worth, I'm not entirely convinced. This book made me rethink an awful lot. I still have a couple of chapters to go in it. But we know that consciousness has a kind of off switch. You flip it and people don't go to sleep. They don't fall unconscious, but they kind of, they zone out. They stare slack-jawed and unaware into infinity. And that switch is not brainstem. It's located in the cerebrum, specifically this blue structure called the claustrum. It's not really blue, of course. Also, as far as I can tell, Soames' books makes no mention of split brain personalities. I've got a couple of chapters to go. He may pull that out of his ass at the end, but it certainly doesn't show up in the book's index. Split brain personalities, those cases where you sever the corpus callosum. And as far as anyone can tell, each half of the brain manifests its own consciousness with its own personality traits, tastes in music, clothes, and so on. Even religion, the neuroscientist B.S. Ramachandran reports meeting one such patient whose left hemisphere was a Christian and whose right was an atheist. And he says he couldn't understand. Ah! God damn it. Okay, I've lost my last slide. I don't know what happened there, but I'll keep going.
Yeah.
He says he can't understand why that kind of a phenomenon didn't shake theology to its core. I mean, in terms of an afterlife, does one hemisphere go to hell and one hemisphere go to heaven? Anyhow, these people, they do have intact brainstems. It's only the broadband pipe between the cerebral hemispheres that's been severed. And yet there appear to be two separate consciousnesses, not one. And that implies that consciousness, to me anyway, has a significant cortical component. Now, I've argued that the ultimate endpoint for cognitive starfaring species amounts to the end of need. And I've also argued that removing our brainstems from the equation will remove our selfish survival drives. And that at least is consistent with Soames' argument. But if Soames is right, and again, I'm not entirely convinced, we're not just talking about the end of need. We are talking about the end of consciousness. Now to our caveman brains, informed by, still mostly ruled by, the brainstem. That might sound horrific. 16 years ago, I wrote a novel which argued that consciousness might be maladaptive. And a lot of folks regard it not so much as a work of hard science fiction as one of existential horror. And now here in real life, it looks as though stripping away all the stuff that makes us selfish, world-destroying assholes may also turn us into philosophical zombies. But it would also make us, for want of a better word, kinder. Such beings would be unable to suffer or need or want. They would have absolutely no motivation to inflict suffering on others. If humanity ever reaches that stage, we will have finally learned to be kind. Now, I was raised in the Abrahamic religions. I have no real insight into the Dharmic ones. And yet, to my ignorant Western mind, losing the conscious self while retaining cognition seems somewhere between the two phases of the Buddhist concept of nirvana. Nirvana with substrate, as I understand it, is the state to where a being remains conscious and aware, but is free of all suffering and desire, the substrate presumably being the flesh in which this consciousness is housed. Nirvana without substrate entails the complete cessation of all feelings, desires, and consciousness. Now, depending on whether my hypothetical purified beings remain conscious, depending on whether the CPU running their minds can be considered a substrate, the purified might qualify for either state, or maybe something in between. And you may find that prospect horrifying, but apparently, over half a billion people on this planet actually aspire to that state. So who knows, perhaps the first interstellar expeditions will be undertaken by Buddhists. I don't really know why, but I find that kind of hopeful. That's all I got. Now I'm going to try and unfreeze my screen.
Peter, thanks. Wow.
Come on, you can do this. Delete.
We can see you, Peter, and hear you.
Well, that's okay. Go ahead and see me. I'm just gonna try and kill and task. Okay. Wait a minute, how do I get back to you? Now I have lost my taskbar. That's kind of weird.
But we do see you and hear you quite well.
Yeah. Okay, well, all I've got is a black screen.
Not buffering.
Thumbnail of Ed. So yeah. Let's go for that.
Okay, shall I chip in?
If you'd like to, David, absolutely.
Thank you for, I mean, for the first half of the talk, you scared the shit out of me, Peter. So, and, you know, that's not going to go away anytime soon. I guess coming at this with my philosopher's hat on, I think what's really fascinating about all the scenario you've explored is that they kind of raise not just ethical questions, but what we might call meta-ethical questions. So just to start, I mean, with the proposal that in a sense, there's something essential to human nature that is, as you say, turns us into selfish, short-sighted arseholes who are in that liable to screw up the biosphere. Your kind of modest proposal for a solution is almost suggests a kind of inversion of the usual kind of Frankenstein scenario that sort of science fiction writers kind of scare us with. So, you know, what's scary about Frankenstein or, similar scenarios, or even something like War of the Worlds, is the idea that, you know, our descendants or ourselves might be replaced by something that's not recognizably us. So, and that's kind of the source of moral disquiet for a lot of speculation in bioethics and philosophy of posthumanism and transhumanism. Will these kind of descendants of ourselves be recognizable as us, with the implication that in some sense there's some ethical problem with them not being recognizably like us?
I mean, isn't that basically biology? Species evolve into other species. You know, we would not be recognized as thecodont lizards. It seems to me that that's just kind of something that you basically take as pretty much axiomatic. Evolution implies change. Yeah.
I think you may be right. I mean, I think there may be a kind of conceptual issue here as well, because in a sense, suppose, this is like the blue pill, green, red pill dilemma in the Matrix, suppose you're given the opportunity to become some kind of post-human, you know, with some vaguely specified difference, but global differences in capacity or intelligence or in emotional dispositions, or stay human. And the worry might be that if you opt to stay human, you have at least some idea what that will involve, because you're already human. You have the kind of ethical dispositions and recognitional capacities of a human being. Whereas, I don't know, suppose you're given the option of sort of becoming a grid-linked brain so in a sense you lose your individuality and you become linked with something like a corpus callosum, but linking you with lots of other brains in some sort of collective consciousness. Now, it's very hard for us to imagine what that would be like. So you might say, well, this is just kind of status quo bias if you opt for the human option, because we're just going with what we already understand. But the problem is there's a systemic problem with understanding the post-human option. So maybe status quo bias is kind of, even though it's perhaps another sort of cognitive bias that's hardwired into us, is also the more rational option here. I'm not suggesting it is, but I'm suggesting that there may be systemic problems with kind of predicting outcomes as well as problems arising from our evolved nature at work here.
Well, I think I would differ with one of your inferences, the one referring to the hive mind and the sort of the group corpus callosum. As you know, I've sort of played around with that idea. It's something that in my fiction and so on, it's something Elon Musk rather short-sightedly, I think, aspires to with his Neuralink program. He explicitly says he wants to link brains to the internet as seamlessly as our brainstem is, or the limbic system is connected to the neocortex. And given that there used to be an individual in the brainstem, and it no longer is an individual because it is fused with the neocortex, I wonder if he has thought through some of the implications of that. But that's not a necessary step in the voyage. You could, I mean, there's no reason why you couldn't create a hive mind, but there's also no reason why you couldn't create a series of partitioned individuals with the bandwidth between them throttled down to the point where individuality is maintained. My understanding is that consciousness decoheres when you have a latency of greater than 400 milliseconds from one side of the system to the other. This would explain why you get two different personalities running in a victim of a corpus callosum. It's not that they're not communicating, it's just that instead of going through broadband, they have to go through the dial-up. So I think you could have individuals running on a single board in a single sort of siloed software application. How it would feel to have all your memories and all your insights, but no instincts to contaminate them. You're right, I agree with that. That's here there be dragons territory, but.
Yeah, I guess it's the kind, in a sense, this is not a criticism of any of your proposals. There just seems to be a kind of an ethical impasse here, because I guess what I'm suggesting, we're in an ideal situation to kind of evaluate what it would be like to stay kind of like more or less baseline human.
Yeah.
But we're not in an ideal, we will only be in an ideal situation to figure out, say, what it might be like to have a lot of our kind of shitty, kin selective instincts sort of removed once it's happened. So there does seem to be a kind of a problem, a systemic problem arrive at making kind of considered judgments about that kind of scenario, which is not simply down to the fact that we're insufficiently objective. It's the ideal situation for making an objective judgment only arises once the decision has been made.
Yeah.
I guess that's...
No, that I get the sense, you've been playing around with these ideas in your own work, from what I can tell from the interviews I've read. The lack of ability to make an informed decision until you've already committed to it.
I think, it doesn't necessarily mean that the idea that we should actually change ourselves, that we shouldn't change ourselves, but there does seem to be a real kind of you know, it does seem to involve a kind of a gratuitous act, as Sartre might, or an element of kind of gratuitous. We simply would have to take such steps, knowing in a sense that the long run consequences of those steps for us, and maybe for the rest of the planet, would be extremely hard to determine.
Well, there's I guess the way, and let's keep in mind, you prefaced your comment with, you know, don't consider this a critique of the proposal. By all means, critique the proposal. It's not even much of a proposal, right? I mean, my job as a science fiction writer is not to predict the future. It's to say, supposing this were the case, what would be the consequences? So I've got absolutely no problem with being proven wrong. I kind of hope I am proven wrong in this case. But that's I think most of the, in terms of the transitions, what seems to me the most likely mechanism would be involuntary imposition. I talk about getting off into space and digitizing yourself, and I make the explicit point that this is, we're not going to do this to ourselves, because, you know, God damn it, Mirtha, that just ain't natural. But we will do it to a digital construct. So that's kind of a natural break point where basically, dude, whether you like it or not, this is how we're going to build you. If you wanted to keep things on a fleshly substrate, there's all sorts of, I mean, you could force a lot of people to give up red meat by taking whatever it is that generates the profound anaphylactic shock that you get when you are bitten by the Lone Star tick. There's this kind of a tick that once it bites you, about a month later, you become deathly allergic to red meat. And I've played around with the idea of figuring that out, CRISPRing it across into horse flies and mosquitoes and basically black flies, everything that bites, so that before too long, a large proportion of the population literally can't risk eating a hamburger for fear of dying. And of course, there are ethical issues here. I'm not even arguing about whether that's good or bad. Somebody at a post-human conference recently sort of threw it out there and was immediately decried as a fascist all over Twitter. All I'm saying is, if it's going to happen, I imagine it's the kind of thing that would have to be thrust upon you rather than the kind of thing many people would volunteer for. So there's always going to be kind of an element of conscription. That said, I mean, what about the Buddhist mindset? You have, you know, you had that famous guy during the Vietnam War who literally sat in a street and set fire to himself. Talk about being able to divorce yourself from earthly pains and needs and wants. I would argue that perhaps to our Western mindset, that sounds horrific, but maybe there are, and again, I know so little about the Dharmic religions, it's not funny, I feel like a complete asshole and an interloper even bringing it up, but I can't help but speculate that there might be on this very planet systems of belief that would embrace the thing that I am saying we have to force on people. But you can tell me whether I've got my head up my ass, because you're going to know way more about that stuff than me, being an actual philosopher.
I suppose you could argue that, I mean, I think a lot of people, say, coming from a humanities background like myself, I'm ventriloquizing them here, would argue that you know, the very fact that you're able to express this concern for our biosphere implies that there may be kind of, or other people are able to express this concern for the biosphere, suggests that there could be, if you like, cultural tricks that could modify our ways of, modify our values, modify our ways of viewing the world, which I guess is what you're suggesting. I mean, my slight concern about a lot of those scenarios is, and it's something you brought up, that even if we save the planet this time, there might be systemic kind of problems that are merely kind of replicated into the future. And that kind of goes back to this suggestion that there may also be systemic reasons why, you know, we introduce lots of uncertainty into the biosphere. I mean, the fact that we use technologies that can be, you know, moved across the planet, well, at least the specifications for a technology can be, you know, transmitted across the planet in a few milliseconds, and then modified, and then turned to new ends. Like, you know, the fact that, I don't know, an old model mobile phone can be reused to activate a bomb or something like that. So technology seems to have got to the point where it's immensely plastic, open to sort of reconfiguration, and often quite cheaply. I mean, some of the kind of biotechnological fixes that you're proposing may even fall into that category. And that doesn't seem to be liable to, that seems to be independent of our kind of biological substrate. That seems, you know, as long as we're able to keep this planetary network running, and that would seem to still introduce a lot of uncertainty into the future of the planet, because that technological infrastructure, if it remains, will give rise to, you know, new developments whose long run implications will be very hard to control.
Yeah, I mean,
so maybe it's not just our human nature, but the kind of the infrastructures that we've kind of scaffolded around us. I would argue that
the infrastructures reflect human nature in the same way that a beaver's dam reflects beaver nature. Mm-hmm. And you know, just to be clear, I'm all in favor of using whatever tricks we can. I'm all in favor, and I do believe that it is possible to supersede and control our instincts. Mm. I absolutely believe that's possible. I also believe it almost never happens. Mm. I believe that what we tend to do, what we tend to use our big shiny brains for, is not to control instincts, but to come up with ever more convoluted self-affirming rationalizations for them. So we're not fighting over resources, we're spreading democracy.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. And we can do all sorts of backflips. We're not mate guarding. We are, you know, fulfilling God's plan for us, or we are protecting the sanctity of marriage. We layer on these rationalizations. And I have played with the idea of hijacking some of these, you know, if you could somehow harness the religious impulse to an environmental bent, that would be great too. But in all of these cases, what you're doing is hacking a flawed system. Mm-hmm. You're coming up with a series of workarounds. And I think you're right when you say that there is going to be future uncertainty. We fix one particular problem because we have used education or tricks or nudge technology or social shaming or whatever we use to move our caveman brains in a desired direction. And whatever we will have done will have the specificity to the problem attached to it. So it'll be good for that one problem, but not for the next one. And that's what I meant when I said that what we're doing essentially, if we fix these problems, is simply buying time.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't seem, I mean, putting aside for the moment the fact that I personally want to go on being me. I like the way I am. I'm wired that way. I recognize that I don't really have any choice in that feeling, but it's still, you know, I will fight to survive. So putting the morality of it aside, it just seems to me a function of empirical fact that if you have a flawed system, that has to be kludged and worked around and hacked differently each time it creates a problem, that's going to be a lot less efficient than fixing the system so it doesn't create the problem in the first place. And we were sort of cobbled together by these short-term instantaneous, you know, genes don't have any foresight, right? There's no way for a gene to look ahead and say, wow, a few hundred years from now, this particular adaptation is really going to bite us in the ass because sugar is going to be everywhere and we'll all get diabetes and tooth rot. We were cobbled together by these things that only work now. And there's no way that I can think of that biology could have produced us any other way. But that does imply certain inherent design shortcomings. And I think that I mean, a lot of, there seem to be a number of people out there from your end of the campus in humanities who take the arguments made by scientists saying that these are natural behaviors and twist them around so that they think we're saying, because these are natural behaviors, we shouldn't try to control them. I think that the reason we're in the predicament we are in now is because we have behaved naturally. And I think that if there is any hope for us, we have to stop behaving naturally and have to start behaving unnaturally as soon as possible. So pointing out that these things are natural does not, to me, excuse them.
Yeah, I mean, there's quite a long philosophical tradition also kind of rejecting the natural as a kind of basis for sort of moral decisions anyway. So it's not, you know, there are different ways of thinking. There are more kind of naturalistic ways of thinking about ethics, but there are certainly ways of thinking about morality which argue that in a sense it's that nature is not a kind of source of ultimate value, that it makes sense to alter nature, you know, for, you know, some higher end perhaps. Can I ask you a question? I mean, I realize I don't want to take up too much time. Maybe other people who want to chip in. But I loved your Moravec metric. You know, this is kind of more of a speculative. Moravec metric, the kind of more speculative, weird end of the talk. So I'm just thinking about the kind, particularly the transition from 2 to 3 or 3 to 4 in this kind of, these step changes of kind of uploaded minds. Because it kind of seems to exacerbate some of the problems of kind of valuation and, you know, ethical decision-making that we were talking about earlier to, you know, the limit. In my book, Post-Human Life, I was interested in some of the kind of speculations about AI ethics that people like Steve Omohundro were writing about, and the kind of scenario that he was considering was that if you had a system like a robot, or it could be an uploaded mind, that was able to, you know, that no longer had the right protect on its kind of functional computational architecture, so it could intervene in its own architecture at a fundamental level, it would probably want to, if you like, pull its value. So for example, if it liked kind of making paper clips, it would clamp its reward system so it will continue to enjoy making paperclips, you know, you know, whatever kind of categorical reason it had to live, it would want to, a bit like you saying you want to remain you, it would want to make, you know, keep doing this kind of stuff because that's what would define it. Now my kind of worry about that scenario, which I think it's perhaps, it's not a concern, it's just a kind of speculative flight, really. I don't know where it leads us. Is that I'm not sure that any system capable, you know, that have the right, you know, that could get under its own hood like this would even be kind of recognizably an agent like us. And the reason for that is quite systematic, that the kind of conscious, and it goes back to the nature of conscious awareness, and I think you mentioned something similar, that consciousness seemed to work by smoothing out a lot of the noise and stuff that we don't need to know about. So I don't know, for all I know, when I see an object in my visual field, what I'm seeing is actually just the synchronized firing of a number of, you know, feature detectors in my brain. That's not what I think I see, but maybe that's what it really is. But insofar as I'm a conscious subject, all that stuff is edited out. I'm not aware of the actual vehicle properties of the representation. I'm just aware of what it's tracking, which is presumably stuff in my environment. And similarly, you know, we use what's called folk psychology to kind of figure each other out and to think about our own lives. You know, we think we attribute desires and beliefs and judgments to ourselves. And I mean, none of this has a direct, is liable to reduce to any kind of neurological level. You know, when you're talking about systems of neurons firing, you're probably not going to find beliefs and desires as we understand them. So any system that was able to kind of investigate itself at that really fundamental level would have very little use for all this kind of homogenized smoothing out that actually makes what we understand as consciousness. It probably wouldn't have an experience like us, but it probably wouldn't even think of itself as an agent with beliefs and desires anymore, because all that stuff could be removed at a single tweak if it changed its substrate. The job of imagining something like that or becoming something like that seems to be unimaginably difficult, again, without, in a sense, going through some sort of iterated step towards it, because we don't, you know, it's not obvious we have the conceptual scheme to kind of, you know, it's what I call a hyperplastic entity. Some people call them hyper agents, but it's not clear that a hyperplastic agent or a hyper agent would even be an agent as we understand it, because we wouldn't be able to even read it or attribute aims to it, which maybe is kind of what, you know, kind of a pretty close approximation to the purified.
You seem to be arguing that agency implies constraint, that you need to be limited in your ability to change.
Maybe
set in stone in order to have agency, which is kind of delightfully counterintuitive, given that agency is generally associated with the ability of making decisions.
Right, that's kind of the irony of this argument, that if you maximize agency, you actually get somewhere that's no longer recognizable as agenthood.
The thing that I would question, though, is
I'm not saying that's a bad thing, because we just don't know whether it's a good thing or a bad thing.
But I think we might. I mean, this is where I bring out, you know, the magic phrase Bayesian inference. You talk about the ability of an entity to essentially look under its own hood and mess with its own guts, but you don't say what technique it uses to do that. Now, you can imagine something that just has a bunch of random number generators in it, kind of like Dawkins' old biomorphs, right? And they just randomly change stuff to see what sticks. And that, I would kind of agree with you, doesn't involve a whole lot of agency. It's just a bunch of dice rolls. And let's not go down, for the time being, the rabbit hole that suggests that we are pretty much doing that now anyway. But on the other hand, if you have, and your word iterative really sort of sticks in my mind, because if you have some kind of a Bayesian process,
sure,
where the system itself, and this is kind of how our brains appear to work, you go in with a preconception, you judge it against your experience, you try to minimize the errors.
Processing. Yeah.
And as a result of that, we change our behavior. Now, swap out change our behavior with change your wiring, your fundamental wiring, change your nature, again, if it's based on some kind of iterative Bayesian process, there's no reason to assume that you would lack agency. What you're basically doing is iterating yourself through a series of upgrades. Again, assuming that you have a systematic way of approaching the change and not just sort of a random scattershot, let's just randomly change characteristics and see what works. Something like that, I think, would just crash and burn almost instantly.
Yeah, no.
Something that was more Bayesian would, I would argue, raise itself to even higher levels of agenthood, because it would apply the same heuristic learning talents to its underlying neural architecture that we do to our ability to learn a new language or memorize dialogue from a Star Trek episode.
Can I jump in here for a second, David? Because there's an interesting sort of skill jump here. On the one hand, there's the question of how we optimize either a small group in the population or the entire world population to be somehow more more generous. I'm not going to say empathic, but less selfish, Peter. And there's a kind of a scenario that's tested out by Chish and Liu in the Three Body Problem books, where this happens. Then there's another scale I'm going to take on, and that scale is what, Peter, I think you take on in The Things, or what you take on in Blindside Echopraxia with Rorschach, which has to do with the possibility of a universal set of evolutionary principles which drive species self-modification or species self-awareness. So, but anyway, in the first case, which is very human, you know, the setup in Chish and Liu's books, without giving too much away, is the aliens are coming, but they're coming from 4 light years away, and it's going to take them, you know, 400 years to get here. So humanity has to try to prepare. And some of humanity gears up for an epic space battle, and some of humanity resigns itself, and some of humanity doesn't give a shit because they're going to be dead in 50 or 70 years anyhow, and they just don't care that the aliens are going to arrive in 400 years. But some of the characters are very powerfully, and some of humanity actually invites the aliens to come because they think we've screwed the planet up so badly that, my goodness, you know, it's Wen Jie, you know, she basically says, come. She makes first contact and she says, come, take over, man. We have screwed this up so badly. And Chish and Liu sets it up so beautifully in the context of the Chinese Cultural Revolution, Rachel Carson's Silent Spring, et cetera, et cetera. It's a really beautiful framing of many problems, Peter, that you've taken on earlier in, for example, your Rifters trilogy. Anyway, but to focus on this one specific example, there are humans who are tasked with planetary defense. They're called the wall facers. And one of the wall facer teams doesn't quite come up with the full insight, but they decide to work on engineering human response. And they, partway through the story, they set up a clinic which allows humans who are part of the planetary defense system, who know that we're gonna lose. Everyone knows we're gonna lose. Anyone who has the rational ability to assess what we're gonna do against the Trisolarian invasion knows we're gonna lose. But we have to keep going anyway. So we go in for a little neural tweak, kind of like what Chelsea does or proposes to do for Siri in Blindside, right? And when they come out of the little neural tweak, which has a whole series of legal checks and blocks to make sure that, you know, you're part of the military and you're going in to come out, what do? You come out knowing rationally that we can't win, but you believe that we can. And so increasingly, in the scenario that Chish and Liu gives us, more and more people, more and more military go in to get this neural tweak. Doesn't change anything about their daily lives, but they feel convinced that somehow we're going to win the battle against the Trisolarians. Now, the beautiful thing that Chish and Liu does here, as you probably remember, is fast forward a few centuries, some people have gone into cryosleep and woken up. We now have a space defense force, thousands of ships that are capable of, you know, relativistic within our solar system speeds. But we don't know how many of the commanding officers or the soldiers on those ships have tweaked themselves neurologically to believe that we can win. And so the commanding force comes to the conclusion that we have to take all the people who've been in cryosleep, who went into cryosleep before this neural surgery was invented. They have to be staffed on the ships so that we have pre-neural tweak and post-neural tweak officers as commanding officers on these starships, or these not quite starships. And it's a really, really interesting scenario for me, because now I'm not going to spoil any more of this for the people who haven't read the trilogy. But it's a really interesting scenario because it maps out precisely, Peter, the challenge that you mapped out that we face. And it's also what Daniela Meadows mapped out with her team in Limits to Growth. And it's also what the Global Catastrophic Risks team at Oxford Future of Humanity Institute mapped out. Humans can see a week or two ahead. They can see their family structure. You ask them to see 2 years ahead, you know, the town system, 5, 10, 50 years ahead, the nation, the planet. Very few people can manage that. And so the tweak that you're proposing could be a tweak that's in relationship to generosity or a removal of strong belief systems, or maybe the addition of strong belief systems, but the addition of altruism as well. But it would have to work in such a way that allows humans, I would argue, to perceive and act across a wider range of timescales. And I've had conversations with some people who you've come across tangentially, Peter and David, I'm sure you know some of them too, Benjamin Bratton over the years, Elizabeth Ellsworth and Jamie Cruz, David Gersten, many people who have tried to take on some of these questions as well. And so it seems to me that, Peter, what you've identified is you've identified the field of operation within which we need to work. And it isn't in the next two generations. It's in the next decade and a half to actually take action. And so that's one part of just the response that I'd want to make. The other part maybe connects more, David, to what you and Peter were talking about, in the sense that I think in blindsight and echopraxia, Peter, one thing that you've done is you've taken on the question of universal galactic scale, potentially, evolutionary pressures, laws of physics, evolutionary pressures. And as you yourself have you know, said many times, humans evolved in a relative oasis, but Rorschach, whatever they are, might have evolved in a much more hostile environment, which left it no time and no energy resources to waste on thinking about thinking. And so the scrambler's inability at the key moment when they're testing them in the cell on Theseus, the scrambler's inability to see themselves, because they never developed the ability to self-perceive, is a byproduct of a universal set of evolutionary pressures that form cognitive structures. And in one part of our galaxy, cognitive structures are formed like us, where we waste all of this time and energy and sugar and heat thinking about thinking and thinking about pleasures and building, you know, waste. But in another place in our galaxy, these creatures or structures or entities or whatever they are have evolved without the luxury of that time to think about thinking or think about feeling.
They've got no higher order modeling. Yeah.
So. And so, you know, I think, David, you know, to kick this back to both of you, Peter, David, one of the questions that I would ask would be what kind of, this is a wildly speculative thing, and, you know, Peter, you've worked on this a lot, and David, in your post-human thinking, you've worked on this a lot too. What base substrate would yield what kind of mind? Because there's a correspondence, you know, between presumably the environment Rorschach evolved out of, and the resource constraints that it had to deal with, or they, or whatever it is, had to deal with, versus the environment we evolved out of. And so the kind of basins and peaks in the broader fitness landscape across our entire galaxy yield different cognitive structures and different drives, different needs, different wants, based potentially on the resource availability. You know, and I have had many conversations with the AI developer, Ben Goertzel, about the same question. What kind of mind emerges out of what kind of context, or what kind of context is necessary to produce what kind of mind? And so this, for me, this becomes a really, really important part, Peter, of the landscape that you've mapped out, because a ton of your work has dealt with that precise question, you know, and just as a PS, you know, you have spent a lot of your time as a biologist, Peter, working on thermal regulation. Energy management, and brains are these big wasteful thermal engines, at least in humans and mammals. And so it becomes part of the central part of this question. So anyway, I hope I've mapped out the two parts of this meditation or question. One is, how do we in the next two decades re-engineer humans? And that, in a way, Peter, that's I think what your whole talk is about. And then maybe bumping it to David, your work as well, what context produces what mind, or what context is necessary to produce what kind of mind? That's an awful lot, but hopefully by trying to simplify it into those two channels, we can talk about it.
I have a relatively clear answer, because I actually wrote a story about that called Incorruptible. And it seems to me the simplest way is to not to give us the ability to control our instincts, but to change our instincts so that we get the same dopamine rush that we normally get from being hedonists, from being living a more Spartan lifestyle. Like basically, you can either tell people, no, you have to give up your hamburgers, you have to give up your own personal vehicles, you have to reduce your reproductive imprint, you have to, you know, you can no longer have that second house in the Catskills, which, you know, people can do. We can control our instincts, but they won't like it much. Or you can rewire them so that when they give up their house in the Catskills, they get off on it. When they cut back on meat, when they reduce everything they do that has a long-term benefit, they actually get a short-term dopamine rush. So the analogy that I use is that utopia is on the other side of the fire pit. You've got to walk across the fire pit to get to it. But because the brain can't see that far ahead, all it sees is the fire. So what you do is you reprogram the brain to get off on charred feet. But then you've got to come up with fixes, because the immediate thing that the brain is going to do is it's going to walk you into the center of the fire pit and then just stand there. So the suffering has to be cognitively linked to the knowledge that you are doing something with a long-term goal. As long as you are moving towards the long-term goal, as long as you are continuing to walk across the fire pit, you continue to get off. The moment you stop and simply indulge in it for its own sake, you habituate. At this point, I still don't think that would be enough. In the story, somebody figured out that trick and realized that they would have had to implement things back in 1995 for it to actually save the planet. But I think that's as much as we could do, because it doesn't involve changing human beings so much as leaving human beings' reward systems in place, just changing the things that give them those rewards that they seek. And again, in terms of the actual implementation of that, I have no idea, but you know, that's not my job. My job is just to throw these ideas out and let other people take them more seriously than they should be.
Yeah, I think I can probably be accused of not really taking, you know, resource limits much into account in the stuff I've written on possible minds, which is you know, probably an error on so many levels. I mean, I'll just go back to the example I used of kind of, you know, just seeing, you know, middle-sized objects. You know, I mean, suppose, you know, when we see a middle-sized object, we're actually seeing some kind of synchronous activity in feature detectors, but the brain kind of neglects that fact because it's not relevant. We're just interested in the salient pattern that helps us kind of navigate around the world. And that you know, so I guess there, and you know, I mean, this has been suggested by cognitive scientists and philosophers like Metzinger, Michael Tye, have argued that, you know, a lot of our experience is transparent. We see through the fog into the world, because we don't need to represent the fog, the neural fog, as it were. And, you know, because we kind of need extra layers of kind of cortical processing to do that, and that's expensive, and it would probably mean that we'd actually have less objectivity. We'd be probably less able to kind of deal with our environments. So, you know, I guess that does raise questions about what kinds of minds, again, could result from, you know, in a sense, not having those computational limits or anything like that. You know, I mean, suppose you know, the computational limits were just kind of, you know, you know, very high-end limits on computational tractability, and, you know, you were otherwise essentially a kind of Turing complete system, you know, with almost effectively unbounded memory, then it's not, I mean, it's interesting going back to Peter's response to me, you know, about basically using Bayesian updating to change one's substrate. I mean, that seems right in the sense that whatever system, you know, if you have a self-modifying system, it would need some kind of agenda to stop it kind of collapsing completely. But the nature of that agenda is very unclear. It's not clear if it could be belief desire thinking, because belief desire thinking doesn't have the level of granularity to deal with, you know, low level tweaks to one's substrate. So it would be driven by some kind of agenda, but interpreting that agenda from our kind of, you know, monkey psychology perspective might be altogether impossible, which, you know, gets us back to this kind of meta-ethical issue of how one takes decisions about post-human futures when the nature of that post-human reality might be, in a sense, incommensurable ethically with our current ethical reality.
Absolutely.
And I think all the proposals that have been fielded so far, you know, even, you know, in terms of tweaking our biases in favor of kin selection, raise kind of meta-ethical issues of that kind, which is not an argument, you know, it's not an argument against pursuing radical modification. It's simply to point out that the level of, you know, philosophical difficulty they raise, you know, which are, in a sense, is unprecedented. We probably have no, extant models to actually deal with them, you know, from within the kind of humanities tradition that I kind of represent.
Can I jump in and address the question, Ed, that you asked to Dave? Hello?
Yes, please. Yeah. Sorry, I was muted.
The thing suddenly occurred to me, the idea of what kind of environment creates what kind of minds on what kind of substrates. And it just occurred to me now, listening to the two of you talk, that what blindsight implies is that the universe is absolutely chock full of intelligent life. Because the argument, as you pointed out, for Rorschach is that the idea that technology implies belligerence, the little mini essay I threw into the middle of the book.
Yep.
And the argument I made was that the things that drive you to the higher pinnacles of achievement have to be intelligent ones. Because once you have adapted to climate, once you have mastered predators, once you have done all these things, they stop being challenges. So there's less pressure, selection pressure on you to get smarter. That the only thing that boosts your intelligence is something that counters your strategies with better counter strategies, basically get you into a Red Queen race where you're always struggling to stay ahead. And this is, I mean, the Red Queen hypothesis has actually been cited as a fairly popular, I don't know if it's still that much currency, explanation for the evolution of sex in life here on Earth. The idea that given that mutation happens so slowly, you need to keep shuffling your genes so that the parasites and the pathogens, which breed so much faster than you and can evolve faster than you, can't get a target lock on your immune system. So we do this genetic shuffling with each generation. But if we take that and look at a system that has been honed to such an extent that it can no longer afford meta-abstraction, that it can be highly intelligent, but it cannot afford to be reflective. What that means is that thing has evolved in a cauldron of intelligent adversaries, not just one or two, but a bunch of them, that the more intelligence there is out there, the less conscious intelligence will be likely to be, because that kind of self-reflection, that kind of conscious self-awareness, is an indulgence that is least affordable when you're fighting other intelligences. So I'm going to have to think about this more, because it just suddenly occurred to me watching you guys talk. But it's an interesting implication that the existence of Rorschach in that universe implies that intelligence is everywhere, but consciousness is nowhere because no one else can afford it.
It's kind of weird because it implies intelligence in a sense without what we call rationality. I mean, like Rorschach is fantastically self-optimizing, but it's not able to kind of give reasons to itself or to anything else why it should self-optimize. It's not able, as you say, to reflect or be aware of itself as a, you know, as a persistent subject. You know, so it's,
but if there's no self to give that, to send that memo to, why is that a bug?
It's not a bug, but it's just completely out. I'm just suggesting it's self-optimization without the ability to give reasons for self-optimization. It would presumably not be able to reflect or alter the drives which lead it to do whatever it does, because that would require presumably some sort of higher order reflection. So it just seems fantastically different from what we think of as a rational subject, you know, within the kind of Kantian, Hegelian kind of philosophical tradition, where we valorize thinking about thinking, because that's kind of what philosophers do. So, you know, that's the kind of model of what rationality involves. Rorschach is something completely weird and alien and outside that sort of narrative.
I would suggest that to some extent we are all kind of Rorschach. It's not that different. I mean, you're familiar with this vast body of literature. It started off with Benjamin Libet in the 80s, showing that we actually, our arms started to move half a second before we made the conscious quote decision unquote to move. There has been more recent research suggesting that sometimes up to 7 to 10 seconds pass before you become aware of making a conscious decision. So if you infer from that the intellectual decision-making process, the computational load, has already happened subconsciously before you become consciously aware of it, because the body does seem to be moving in response to some kind of a decision that has been made, then what is the point? So much of what we do is unconscious anyway. So much of what we think we have decided turns out to be memos received after the fact. So basically, if you take a human being, you let them behave exactly the way they normally would, but you intercept every memo, the body, the brain makes its decision, it runs its calculations, it sets the body in motion, and then you interrupt the memo that it sends up to the little pointy-haired boss sitting behind your eyes, so that the pointy-haired boss never gets that, but everything else in the system runs as it always has. Does that make a difference to the behavior of the organism? Does that change anything? Or is it like a little one-way Markov blanket thing where, you know, the little pointy-haired boss now becomes aware of it, but doesn't really have any impact because the decision's already been made? And if so, why not get rid of the pointy-haired boss? I'm not actually positing that Rorschach is all that different from us. Rorschach kind of is us, but without that final step of sending the memo to the worthless little appendix up there in the corner.
Of course, the worthless little appendix might be working on slower timescales, so it may be intervening and molding behavior, but not at the speed of the kind of you know, that particular actions or movements are adopted. So, I mean, I'm presuming that sort of reflection and thinking about, you know, I don't know, deciding what to decide, or deciding what kind of values should motivate us, does have some kind of effect, but it may not, it may just be much slower, and in a sense wouldn't necessarily come up in something like the Liebert, the sort of timescales that the Liebert experiments are working
on. Okay, but even if that happens, if you buy into materialism, all the computational stuff that happens that informs your conscious reflection has to predate your conscious reflection, right? The conscious reflection, unless you're a dualist, the conscious reflection is an epiphenomenon. It's an end product of all this computation.
Yeah, I'm not denying, I'm not sort of saying that I'm not quite making some voluntarist case about free will, that we got some kind of a causal link or something, or there's some soul or whatever. It's just, you know, we can just assume that there's some process which is functionally distinct from a lot of the processes that Liebert is looking at, which, I mean, I think in dual process theory, the distinction is made between system one and system two. So system one is kind of fast and dirty, often works by association rather than inference, whereas you've got slower culturally invested system two, which is, you know, more slower, more language bound, more concept bound. You know, I guess, you know, there may be models whereby this system can intervene in the lower level process without necessarily controlling it. And presumably it might, if predictive processing is right, it might be higher, you know, it might be models modeling models all the way up, you know, so I'm not kind of denying that.
I mean, Metzinger, who I'm glad that you cited a name that I was actually familiar with.
Yeah.
Metzinger kind of put shone a light on that for me by basically showing in very clear terms why consciousness has to be transparent, why we can never have conscious access to conscious programs, because if you did, then those would collapse from being a global process to being a local one, and you'd need something outside of that to look in. The outer layer of the onion must always be transparent. And I thought that was very cool. But I guess what you gotta factor in is obviously the conscious epiphenomenon that results from your behavior of the moment can't affect the behavior of the moment because it comes along afterwards. But what it could do is feed back into future behaviors. It changes, you know, it changes the Bayesian odds, basically. So two questions. Firstly, can we establish that consciousness, that conscious reflection actually does change future behavior? And it seems to me pretty obviously that's got to be a yes. Secondly, could you kind of scrape the conscious foamy part off of that computation and get the same result by just doing the precursors that ultimately result in conscious reflection, but still reflect subconscious computation? Could you just take the computation and use that as the feedback? In which case, yes, this is what we use consciousness for, but no, consciousness is not the only or necessarily the best way to do that.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. And I'm, you know, a lot depends on what you think consciousness is. You know, I mean, you know, according to some models, consciousness just is kind of higher order computation or you know, reflection on. So in a sense, what you're describing is consciousness rather than something with consciousness kind of creaming off the top. But no, I'm quite open to that.
Can I jump in here, guys? We have about 15 minutes left, and I wanted to see if anybody in the audience had any questions that they wanted to float to you. And if so, Peter and David, you guys could address that.
I saw. Could I just, Could I just boot out of this?
Yeah, Peter,
could I
please.
Boot out of this and then try and boot back in, because I'm still got a black screen here. So let me, I'm going to try and reboot, and then you can let me back into the conversation in about 2 seconds.
Oh, really? Because we might lose you in the meantime.
Seriously?
I don't know. I'm concerned about losing you for...
Because I don't have any access to chat functions. Like, I'm looking at a blank screen with a little thumbnail of you. When David's talking, I get a thumbnail of David. I don't even see the two of you side by side.
Oh, gosh. Okay. Then let's do that. Why don't you go out and come back in? Yeah.
Okay.
The good thing is we've seen you the whole time. Loud and totally clear. Yeah.
This is where we activate the Peter Watts simulation. Minus higher order kind of reflective processes.
Exactly. To everyone who's with us, do you want to float any thoughts or questions in the chat, or raise your hands in Zoom to let us know that you want to drop a quick question into the conversation? You know, David, while we're waiting for Peter to come back in, this last bit has reminded me very much of another sci-fi novel by Greg Ian, Shield's Ladder. And if you know, do you know it?
What's the title again?
Shield's Ladder.
Yeah, I've read it. Yeah, no, it's coming back.
It's this one where sort of post-humans are running on small, like walnut-sized quantum computers that are embedded in a kind of a bipedal human body, which is effectively, disposable. And the question of free will is handled in an interesting way there, because presumably anytime a human, I'm sure these computer systems running on these quantum computers, needs to make a decision, what they do is they run the thought process decoupled from any physical interference. And then they reconnect to physical reality, and there's a kind of a decoherence back into a timeline then. So while they're thinking, at least as I've always understood that part of the idea, they're really in an atemporal and completely non-physical, or as non-physical as one can get and still be running on a computational physical substrate. And then the decision made then links back to the physical world, which then links it back to a timeline, it links it back to temporality. And so the idea there in a way is that humans or organisms in general never really had anything even approximating free will until they could decouple from physical timeline, destination, destiny constraints and run thought processes and decision processes. Yeah.
Yeah, I admire your capacity to kind of remember all the kind of the premises introduced in multiple SF novels, because I just read this stuff and kind of homogenize it horribly. But that's a wonderful idea, because it implies that kind of free will, in a sense, our idea of free will is something that is an idea, actually something that hasn't yet been invented, but will need some fantastically advanced technology to kind of produce it. I think it's just a cool idea. In the novel, was this kind of atemporal state some also non-physical in some way, or was it kind of
I don't really remember. They still lived very much like humans. They still had kind of emotions and drives and sexual desires and survival instincts. And so on that level, it was a little disappointing to me, because I have always imagined that if we got to the state where we ran on a little walnut-sized quantum computer, many of us probably would go in directions that had no need to re-embed ourselves in a kind of a quasi-human bipedal, wet robot to keep going as humans have gone on for so long. So in that sense, they still were very much coupled. The other subplot, or the main plot driver in Shield's Ladder, Peter, it's the Greg Egan novel we're talking about for a second there, is that one of the characters runs a physics experiment I think it's like 300 light years off in, you know, in the edge of a quiet pocket in the universe, and it catalyzes a collapse of space-time. And this collapse of space-time expands, and her character is destroyed there, but her backup back on Earth is still running, and humans are still running out there. And so the novel then, in the second act of the novel, effectively follows a research station which is riding on the front end of the shockwave of this expanding universe collapse to try to understand what the universe collapse is and what the laws of physics are inside it. And that's as close as it really gets to talking about a non-physical nature of consciousness. But it isn't in the sense that you're mentioning it.
Yeah. I'm just actually, because since you said they're quantum computers, maybe it's some kind of decoherent.
That's the way the idea of consciousness and free will is argued,
Sort of kind of what, you know, wave function, which is kind of at once in all these different possibilities. And then, so it's a collapse. It's a, I see. Yeah. Yeah, that's a wild. It's a wild idea. I guess it, it always amuses me that a lot of these speculations kind of assume, you know, really major kind of metaphysical commitments, like the idea that, you know, uploaded minds would be uploaded minds assumes that some kind of functionalism would be true. And you know, this obviously implies realism about wave functions or whatever, you know. Wave functions are, or whatever wave functions kind of measure. It's kind of.
Yeah. Peter, you can see us now, right?
I can. I'm back. It's all normal. I got my taskbar. Everything's fine.
Awesome. Hey, audience, do you want to, anyone want to jump in and ask a question or two of Peter and David? I still see some familiar faces here, and I know that some of you are, you've been reading Peter's work. And James, please.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, hear you very well.
Okay, I guess this is a question for Peter. I was thinking about your digitized, purified people. I guess they're people. So
entity.
They've been sent out. Entity, yeah. So that's, you know, that helps us get past a problem of mass, so we can send stuff out, or these dudes out pretty far. Now, is the ultimate ending that they're going to be turned back to meat, the way you see it? Because I don't see why they'd want that. And then if they don't want to, I don't see why I want them to be, you know, out there, let's say.
Well, there's basically you're saying what's in it for us. I guess my response would be we're screwed anyway. I think there are, I think there is something in our, you know, wetware, meaty, brain stemmy cells that does care about legacy.
Yeah,
I mean,
hell, sure.
There are people who will fly airplanes into buildings. Obviously not something that increases their inclusive fitness here on Earth. But they have been hacked by something that allows them to have had an impact. And I think that to some extent, given a choice between we just sink into the mire with Triceratops here versus we sink into the mire, but our children go off and get great degrees at MIT and you know, model, marry movie stars and become billionaires. Like that's something everybody wants for their kids. There's essentially an instinctive drive to have your kin do well and to prosper. If we could hang on to that particular instinct, I think that might motivate such a program. If you think the world is fucked and you are about to die, the idea of sending off some incarnation of you at least allows you to die thinking that you've accomplished something and that your heart will go on. Albeit hopefully not that particular heart, because that would be a really bad way of presenting ourselves to the universe at large.
Mm, yeah.
But yeah, no, I don't think, my thinking is that, if you have a,
if you insist on using something like Starshot as a delivery platform for meat at the other side. And this is not my idea. A lot of other people have sort of imagined similar scenarios. You can do that. But I also think that the idea of spreading through the universe as a series of von Neumann replicators is probably more parsimoniously doable. And if you're comfortable on that motherboard, if you can, have you ever played a game called Soma? Video game? Yeah,
I have it in my Steam list, haven't installed it yet.
It's pretty good. There's not as much, the player doesn't have as much impact on the outcome of the game as a sandbox thing, but it's a very interesting game that sort of explores issues of consciousness. And one of the endings is your digitized personality ends up in this incredibly wonderful virtual environment. And it's pretty much like what we would consider to be a paradisical environment. There, you have instantiated essentially a version of yourself in electrons. And the last scene in the game basically shows this satellite sort of drifting away with this whole virtual world inside it while the Earth burns. And so you could, I would imagine that even if you like what you are, and assuming the technology exists, you could have whatever kind of a life you like in a digital editable environment, which would not be the case if you try and reinstantiate yourself as meat, around Proxima Centauri. So I would argue that just purely for personal greed and hedonistic reasons, we would probably rather stay as electrons, and that you would want us to stay as electrons because, like it or not, we're your kids. And you want what's best for your kids.
It's interesting, Peter, because there's a moment in Blindside, I think it was, where Rorschach is talking with them on Theseus, and the humans say something along the lines of, the fireflies, they're talking about the fireflies, and Rorschach says something like, hey, when our kids fly, they're on their own.
Yeah.
And of course, one never knows if Rorschach understands the question, but I've always assumed that Rorschach, to some degree, understood the question, and the response is very simple and honest. It's like the dandelion letting go of its seeds. When our kids fly, they're on their own. That's the way we do it. That's the rule set that produced us. That's where they're going. We don't worry about that because we don't worry about anything, but we understand your question because we're the ultimate Chinese room, even though we don't understand your question. So the answer to your question, which we don't understand.
This is what I'm going to say. Even if the answer to the question is perfectly coherent and makes perfect sense, you cannot say that Rorschach by definition understands anything. not in the way. You can say that Rorschach has computed an optimal response.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, James, I wonder if this takes on some of the things that you were wondering about.
Yeah, it sort of clarifies a bit. The funny thing is when I think about, stuff like that, I'm just more worried not about, the humanity's future. It's like, I just hate the thought of all our art. My favorite apps would just never be appreciated somewhere, so.
Well, believe me, if I ever had the chance to get myself digitized, you'd be sure I'd be taking on a complete collection of Jethro Tull CDs. Those puppies are going to Bernard Star.
There you go, man. Forget Goldberg variations, right? Anybody else want to chime in? Because we're kind of at the limit of what we planned for today's session. Anything in the chat? Anyone want to jump in here?
There's a chat.
This was a really wonderful and wide-ranging conversation.
Well, I think we've tuckered them out.
Yeah, Stephen Shavira was here. He had to jump out earlier, but he said thank you. He had to leave, but thank you. Thank you, everybody. Yeah, thanks for joining today. Peter, David, awesome. Thank you so much.
Thanks for inviting me. That was That was a great experience. And, you know, I'm going to be thinking, my mind's going to be worrying about this for the next few weeks, I suspect, or months.
Still a pretty piss poor substitution for like sitting in a bar and drinking beers and talking about this.
Well, it's true. Hopefully by next year, we'll be able to get back to that.
I think we're going to sort of uncork some wine tonight. So, do it as consenting adults.
I'm going to uncork some wine right now.
Yeah.
It's only a few hours into my future, too. All right.
Thank you. Thanks, thank you again, everyone, for showing up. It was a blast.
Thank you, Pete, for an amazing talk.